And this next gentleman along the same line, he was a giver, and he taught me things. I asked him questions. He would take the time to sit off and teach me. And I love him because he's had two characters. I knew him as Whit Haydn. And then he came up to this point in his life where he reinvented himself. He just reinvigorated himself. He came with this character, and he can do this, both acts, but he can do this till he dies. And that's the creativity. That's one of the things I really like about this guy the most. His big heart and his creative mind. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Whit Haydn, officially known as Pop.
Thank you very much. I am Pop Haydn. I'm very pleased about that myself. Folks, in every IBM magic show is required that we always do some classic of magic, and I drew the short straw. Well, because classics, as you know, often means lame. And this one is kind of lame. It's called a six-card trick. First, we have to set the stage. Stage, but it's not much of a trick. It's called a six-card trick. He uses exactly six playing cards. It's a classic of magic. I happen to have exactly six playing cards here with me, which I know for a fact because I counted them myself. And I was a professional card counter in Las Vegas. But for the sake of science and for the record, let's count them together again. We have one, two, three, four, five, six. Sorry, someone's been screwing with the props. It's not that funny. We'll count them again. It's important we be on the same page. One, two, three. Take one of these six cards, toss it out this way, and still have one, two, three, four, five, and six playing cards. I know you're laughing because you don't think that's possible. But it is, and it doesn't matter. I can throw it out this way, I can throw it out that way. It's not going to make any difference. But still, we have what? One, two, three, four, five. Is that not fun?
Yes.
Hold on a second. One, two, three, four, five. Oh. I thought I made a mistake. Obviously not. Now, folks, here's the idea. We have one, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. Folks, I apologize. I am so sorry. This is obviously something off about the mathematics in this room. It may have been built before the new math, I can adjust. And I'll show you a classic feat of magic using one, two, three, four, five, and six playing cards. And I'm going to throw away one and still have one and two and three and four and five and six. Now we got that trick over. I'll show you some magic. Want to see some magic?
Yeah.
Oh, good. This is but I'm not saying it's real magic. But I'm not saying it's not either. I just have to do it for you. You have to figure it out for yourselves the way I do. You take a white silk scarf, place it into the hand. It goes in white, but it comes out red. I know. Goes in white, comes out red. Looks like magic. Looks like that white scarf is turning it into a red scarf by some kind of mystical, magical hand-dyeing process. I mean, it looks good from here. How's it look from out there? It looks like magic. It looks like that red scarf has changed colors. It looks like the white scarf turned into a red scarf. That's not what happened, folks. The secret is, I have another scarf. I know. It's so stupid when you know. See, the idea was, when I was off stage, I was shoving this thing into my hand just as fast as I could, because it was kind of a short introduction. Once the scarf was all the way in here like this, take this scarf. This is called palming. This is called misdirection. Palming, misdirection. Palming, you have to be kind of casual with this hand. So you don't, you know, draw attention to it. This is misdirection. When you're doing this, people don't even want to look at this hand. Because you can't show this hand to them. I can, but you should. Now, you start placing it into the hand like so, it comes out what? Because you have that red scarf hidden in the hand. You go in this way, it comes out this way. It looks like magic. It looks like magic, but it's not. It's a stupid trick. Going with that. That's the way to hold it. Okay, and then that's it. It looks like magic. If you don't know how. At one time or another, you've probably seen a magician take a piece of rope and cut it and put it back together again. I'm going to do the same thing, but I'm going to show you step by step how it's done. Before we start, I'd like to have someone from the audience thoroughly examine this piece of rope, make sure it is, in fact, what it appears to be, an ordinary, unprepared piece of rope. Would you, sir, go over every inch of that? Thank you so much. I'm kidding. Make sure there are no trap doors or mirrors. No hidden assistants. It doesn't stretch or anything. Is it like an ordinary person? I'm just kidding. Otherwise, I wouldn't have let you look at it. Just a piece of rope like you find in any bedroom. The secret. But the secret is not in the rope, it's in a special knot the magicians have kept secret for hundreds of years, called the Mongolian hop knot. It was invented by the famed horsemen of Mongolia. It's a kind of a slip knot. Sometimes those boys had to leave town in kind of a hurry. The first step is to measure the rope carefully. You want to make sure that when you cut, you get two pieces of rope exactly the same length. To put these back together again, you tie a Mongolian hop knot. Here's how it is tied. You take one rope, twist it around the other rope like this, come back over this way, come around, come through, and pull tight. You go back and forth the same way as you went in and out, and then you go in and out at the same time as you went back and forth. You twist, come around. Some of you are laughing, but there's people here trying to learn. You twist, come around, and pull tight, you have one Mongolian hop knot. That's it. Thank you. At this point, you simply reach in your pocket, you take some magic pixie dust. You sprinkle the pixie dust on the knot. I call it pixie dust. I don't know what they call it in Mongolia. In a few seconds, that pixie dust will cause the knot to dissolve and pop right off the rope, leaving you where you started from. Now, some of you may have a hard time seeing exactly how to tie that knot, especially those of you in the cheaper seats. So we'll do it again. This time I'll go slow. And this time we'll cut the rope into three even pieces, which gives you twice as much chance to see how the knot is tied. Am I going too fast? Very seldom happens. Now remember, folks, when you try this at home, make sure you cut all three pieces of rope the same length. If you make a mistake here, the trick will not work. For example, if instead of cutting three ropes all the same length, you would make a mistake and get one of the ropes a little bit short, the trick won't work. You get one rope about right and the other rope too long, the trick won't work. All three ropes have to be the same length. Well, this could happen to anyone. So if it happens to you, there is a way out. As long as I'm teaching you the trick, I'll teach you what we magicians call a contingency plan. Make a mistake cutting the ropes, you fold them over one at a time, like this. Short, medium, and long, and you say the magic words, sim, salabim. You have to say these with a certain amount of conviction. Sim, salabim. I know it's stupid, but it works. Leave it where you started from. Now, back to the Mongolian pot knot. You take rope number one and rope number two. I'm going to tie these together. Watch closely. I'll go slow. Take one rope, twist around the other rope like this. Come back over this way, come around, come through, and pull tight. You go back and forth the same way as you went in and out, and then you go in and out at the same time as you went back and forth. You twist, come around, and pull tight. You have one Mongolian pot knot. The second knot is tied the same way. You may want to take notes. You take one rope, twist around the other rope like this, come back over this way, come around, come through, and pull tight. You go back and forth the same way as you went in and out, and then you go in and out at the same time as you went back and forth. You twist, come around, and pull tight. You have two Mongolian pot knots. Everybody with me? Yeah. At this point, you simply reach in your pocket, you take some magic. Pixie dust, that's very good. That's very studious. You sprinkle the pixie dust on the knots like this. Any questions so far? What? Oh, where do you get the pixie dust? There's a question. there's an answer. But a little flippant. I grind my own. Not just for economy, for purity. In a few seconds, I send the kids out of the house. You know, pixies can make a heck of a noise in a blender. It can be stressing for your very young. In a few seconds, that pixie dust will cause the knot to dissolve and pop right off the rope. Sometimes when I'm teaching magic to audiences such as this, people will miss some step in the trick, even when it's being explained from this greater distance. Sometimes it's helpful to have a little personal instruction. What I'd like to do is find someone from the audience who'd like to learn the world's oldest magic trick. We have a volunteer. Come on up. Let's give him a hand. Let's boo. Give him a hand.
Step into my office.
your name? Parker. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Parker. Where are you from, Parker? Sparta? Sparta, Michigan. Parker, have you ever done a magic trick before? Perfect. I'm going to teach you how to do one of the world's oldest magic tricks. You have to pay close attention, okay? Oh, shut up. This is a classic. You have to learn it. My Great Expectations. Over 2,000 years old, the ancient miracle of the Chinese linking rings. Parker, this is ring number one. This is ring number two. This is ring number three. And this is ring number four. Four separate answers. You with me so far?
Yeah.
Good. Which one is this?
Oh, one.
One, exactly. Can you guess this ring, too?
Yeah, it's two.
See, this is going to be a lot easier than you thought. What I want you to do, pick a spot on your ring, any spot at all that looks like a solid spot to you. Hold your ring just like this, so a solid spot will be right up there. That's great. Does that look like a solid spot to you right there?
Yeah.
Did you notice any holes in your ring anywhere? You can laugh, Parker, but without this hole, the trick wouldn't even work. Without this hole, it wouldn't even be the ancient miracle of the Chinese linking rings. Be the ancient miracle of the Chinese linking hubcaps. The idea is to take this hole and put it in that hole. In order for that to happen, solid steel has to pass through solid steel. The miracle of penetration. Ready? One. Two. Three. I know. That's the first part of the trick. Second part of the trick is to take the rings apart and hold them just like this. You give them a spin this way in kind of a circular motion. And then you blow right here in the center. Very, very, very. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time on any stage, presenting Parker the Magnificent, in a feat of prestidigitation and legend of name, over 2,000 years old, the ancient miracle of the Chinese linking rings. Let's do it! This is ring number two. I want you to hold the rings up just like this. That's perfect. This is ring number three. This is ring number four. I'll hold mine up the same way. On the count of three, I want you to drop one ring like that. On the count of three, so it links into the other ring. Hold one ring tight, let the other ring drop. Watch your foot. Ready? One, two, three. Oh, yeah, that was a good try. Let's do it again, okay? First, take the rings apart. First, you do this. Give this ring a spin. Perfect. Step back with one foot. Throw one arm back like this. Okay? And then you give the ring a spin, and then do that. Right? Got the idea? When you do this, an intelligent audience will burst into a... Give them a spin this way, kind of a circular motion. Okay, don't use quite so much wrist action. You're gonna do it going like this, and then you're gonna blow right here in the center. Ready? One, two, three, blow. And go right to each other. Now, so one ring up your arm, put the other ring down in your hand. Take the ring on your shoulder and give it a push so it slides all the way down your arm, back inside this ring. Like so. that hang up. That's good, the other ring is hanging up. Okay, so your left hand reaches the hole like this. Good. Grab this ring down here. Go straight out through the hole like that. Put it back through the hole the same way. So you end up with two rings linked back to it. Look at you. The most difficult and the most dangerous method ever devised. Taking two solid metal rings apart. Ready for this? Hold your rings like this, like a bow and arrow. What's your. Turn a little more for me. What you're going to do is take the ring in your right hand, give it a spin so it goes sailing around this ring, it'll pass through right about there. Its momentum will carry it back towards your hand, loose at a speed of about 20 miles an hour. In order to avoid serious bodily damage, you have to take the right hand and thrust it through the ring as it comes around. Got the idea? Here we go. Ready? Get set. One. Two. Three like that. Come right off. Take that same ring. Throw it straight up in the air like this. Catch it in there.
Ladies and gentlemen,